Good afternoon and welcome to Safari Live. My name is Brent Leo Smith and you're joining us for the Sunset Safari. I have Vim on camera. We have Jamie and Brian out in the other vehicle. And we have Kirsten and Rebecca in final control. So welcome to what promises to be a riveting next few hours out in the middle of the African bush. Barely a cloud in the sky. And of course, I'm failing to mention these two beautiful individuals who are just over my shoulder. Two young Ellie bulls, probably mid-20s. So not fully grown yet, but definitely on their way. Well, they've been hanging around quarantine for most of the day. Actually had this one closest to us right outside my window when I woke up this morning from my little sleep-in. Just on the other side of the fence, feeding along the edge of our house. And I do love spending time with Ellie bulls. Very peaceful and calm. Not so much of the frantic hustle and bustle of a breeding herd. Feeding on the lovely grasses that have sprung up on quarantine, and they're going to take as much advantage of it as possible until it stops seeding and growing, because it is going to be a very long dry season. I think we're going to see them feeding on a lot more trees and bushes this year than what we normally do. Now, I was hoping these guys might meander down towards the waterhole, but they have been at a waterhole already today. I can see some mud on them. Oh, what? What do you want? Suddenly decided to lift his head a little bit there. But don't worry, he's not doing anything. He's just showing us he's big. You see how he's opened his ears like that? This is very typical elephant bull behavior. And we're not going to chase him away or just yet. But if he does come too close, I will have a word with him about behaving. Now, you often find Eddies do that. It's just to remind you that, in their minds, that they're very big and strong and they're not to be trifled with, and we know that. But a lot of times you can incite a negative reaction by moving the vehicle at the wrong time. And we can see how incredibly versatile that trunk is. Now, as he sniffs, he scoops around, picking the exact little plant or grass that he wants. At the moment there, he's got a bit of a smorgasbord. He had about three different species. Trying to see exactly what it is. Looks like he had some wild basil there. And a little bit of a devil thorn. Looks more like some panicum. Now, often people, when you buy a vehicle or whatnot, if you live in a hot area, buying a dark colored vehicle is often not a good idea. And now this is where elephants break a lot of those rules. I mean, if we look at them, he's big, he's dark, and he's one of the only animals that operates in the heat of the day. Now, they have this incredible evolutionary adaptation for that. And those are the ears. Up to nearly 9 liters of blood, so 2 gallons of blood are in an elephant's ears at any one time. And oh wait, he might move past. There we go. He's flapping them, cooling the blood and sending it through the rest of the body. And from the outside, you can't really see, but you see behind his ear, there's a myriad of veins and blood vessels. Now, the ears themselves are cartilaginous, so they're not. They are rigid, but you definitely see in the older animals, specifically up on this top here, that it starts to bend inwards as they get older and the edges don't hold as well. And the inner ear is actually right there. And you can actually see there's quite a lot of fine hairs and things there that just help protect it. Now, a lot of you are probably wondering what that white spot is at his eye. Now, that's probably just a very similar sort of thing to what we call sleep, but you probably find it's been quite windy today, and it's a buildup of dust and other irritants that have been pushed out of the eye. Now, there are hundreds of thousands of muscles in an elephant's trunk that enable it to have that degree of movement. You might give us a sneak peek behind the ears. And he's still just a little bit. I don't want to move the car just yet. It's wonderful to have these bulls around. Now, as I was saying, they're not quite finished growing yet, and we'll get a little bit bigger still. And it must be an incredibly frustrating life for an elephant bull for the first nearly 30 years. They reach sexual maturity at around 14, but are unable to mate till they're about 30. And that's just purely due to competition. The big bulls will keep the younger guys away from the females, and you'll find your biggest and most dominant bulls in their prime all come into that must cycle around the same time. So they're the guys who are competing for the breeding rights at the best times of the year. And those must cycles fall in cycle for the time of the year that has the most females in estrus. So elephants will only mate when the male is in must and the female is in estrus. Mike says, this Ellie reminds him of Mr. Wrinkly Bottom. Have we seen him recently? I actually haven't. You might find, as he's got older, the skin might have tightened and won't be so obvious, that very distinct wrinkles he had in his skin. But I haven't seen his herd, so it is possible they're out in a different area at the moment, but hopefully they will come back for a visit. And you quite often find these young bulls and twos and threes and sometimes in bigger numbers. And I do like to keep company, but just not the company of the breeding herd. Quite often now, because there are quite a lot of very big must bulls in must at the moment, like the naughty elephant who's got the hole in his ear. If these guys happen to meander too close to a breeding herd, he would see them off quite sharply. And there you can see I'm talking about that. As they get older, that top edge of the ear, the cartilage doesn't hold its shape as well and starts folding over. Now, on sort of very old elephants pushing into their 40s and older, it's even far more obvious. So we're going to leave these gentle giants to carry on with their munching on quarantine, and let's go say good afternoon to Jamie, who's got a smaller grey tusked beast and a big fat cow.
We do indeed. And good afternoon to you all, and welcome to our sunset safari. Two big fat cows, and then two smaller tusked animals standing at the back. There were four warthog sharing this mud wallow, on a blistering hot afternoon in the African bush, enjoying the cool muddy water. Interestingly enough, this group of warthog is not relaxed at all, which is why at the moment we're sitting so far away from them, just because they looked as though any second they were going to dash off and run away from us. So I've been giving them plenty of space so they don't disappear. And on a hot afternoon, these pans around, and you can see how covered in mud these warthogs are. These pans, in other words, mud wallows that have become almost like ponds, have become a gathering place or a gathering point for the buffalo of the reserve to come and spend some time in them. And as a result, This entire area around Twin Dams Road has acquired something of a barnyard smell. The buffalo are not terribly hygienic when it comes to spending a bit of time in water, so they will urinate and defecate in it, which is one of the big reasons why, even though these lovely pans are available, the elephants do not come and drink from them anymore. As soon as they become soiled, the elephants show a preference for moving around elsewhere. And already a lot of them have largely dried up. Hello, boy. Showing that sort of cow-like curiosity. But good afternoon, my name is Jamie. This afternoon, I have Brian on camera with me. We will be exploring the wilds of Juma and Arethusa Game Reserves. Let's see what else we can find. Have a look at the pan that he's been lying in. Hello, boys. Amazing how many buffalo bulls there are on Juma at the moment. We went through a period where we barely saw a buffalo for about a week. Oh, there's even one. Oh, that is a good, there's two, three, four, never mind. There's a load of them. Amazing how they can disappear. And they're back in those wallows. Three, four, five, six, seven. Just in this little area, there are nine buffalo bulls. The back there is a much larger pan. It's known as Chele Pan on this reserve. And it's a really beautiful setting. The shade of the tall leadwoods around it. This little pan would have started life as just a puddle, with warthogs then coming and having a good rub around, and then buffalo joining in, until eventually, with the combination of all the animals, including the elephants, digging out and excavating the walls, it becomes almost like a pond, and a perfect place for the animals to come and drink, and for the buffalo to come and enjoy an afternoon at the spa. Nice cool spot. And it's just been, I've just seen a flash of movement behind the trees, but it's just Inyala walking at the back. They might be thinking about coming for a drink. Look at how hidden those buffalo bulls are. I mean, our camera sits up quite high on the vehicle. If you were walking through on foot, and if there weren't other buffalo to alert them of your, or alert you of their presence, that would come as quite a nasty surprise if you wandered into those boys wallowing there. But it's nice to see these buffalo looking so large and healthy. Nigel's even commented saying, seriously, are we still in the same country, or has Safari Live moved? It has just, the landscape has changed so vastly over the last 2 weeks that it really does feel like we're in a completely different part of Africa. And the buffalo are thriving. That being said, and I commented on this last time, with all of the rich grass, it seems to have given them all diarrhea. I've noticed it across the board, and I think it's just because their stomachs have actually, perfectly timed. I think it's actually because their stomachs have got so used to coping with very, smelly as well, coping with very dry, very unappealing grass, and now all of a sudden they're faced with this wonderful selection. And I think it's a little bit like eating rich food after months of starvation almost. But it's wonderful, it gives them an opportunity to really bulk themselves up before we start entering into our dry season. And apparently, I hear rumors that there might even be a little bit more rain on the way over the next few days. What do you think about that, boy? Yes? Does that sound like a good idea? I think so. He can't quite decide which way around the bush he's going to go. A little bit of indecision there. Time to go off and join the rest of his buddies in the pan. Apart from the smell of the water, I'm almost tempted to go and join them on this burning afternoon. Despite the fact that it is autumn, it definitely still feels incredible. The sun feels incredibly strong. And I just popped past Juma Dam on my way here, and already it's on its way to drying out. There's hardly any water left. So it didn't last very long at all. But I do plan on making my way across to Treehouse Dam. There's been plenty of water there, so we'll go and investigate, see if possibly Karula, the Queen of Juma, our lovely female leopard, has decided to come back onto Juma from where she's denning her cubs. And also, as the afternoon starts to cool down, there's also the distinct possibility that the Nkuhumas might decide to wander back across our western boundary and back onto Juma. They were seen resting up in the shade on a property called Simbombili, which is probably about 100 meters away from where we could be.
Jeremy, Jeremy.
Brent's just trying to get hold of me. As you could hear, standing by.
What's your route?
I've taken Twin Dams down to Chelepan. I'm going to go to Treehouse from here.
I'm going to go engage and then look up mine.
Copy that. Now, I'm not sure if Brent updated you on... of getting into each other's space there. I'm not sure if Brent updated you on the lion events of last night. Now, last night there was tremendous vocalization coming from the Birmingham boys and the Salati males. The Birmingham boys actually raced into Biffle's Hook and chased the Salati males all the way to the north, to the property to the north of that called Manuleti. There was a bit of a... I don't know if there was an actual physical clash. All we can tell from the tracks, nobody was there to witness it, but what it looks like from the tracks is that they just scared them off up to the north, and they've now settled. Two of the Birmingham boys have settled to the property to the north of us, and there's a couple more around Torchwood, so to the east of us. And some interesting times. The Birmingham boys, I was wondering if that, or when that was going to start happening, that conflict between the Birmingham boys and the Salatis. Know that the Salatis have clashed with the Birmingham boys before, but that was before the Birmingham boys actually fully conducted the takeover that they've now successfully carried out. And that was when they were much younger, much smaller, and quite easily beaten off by the Salati males. This time the tables have turned, it seems. That might also be something worth at least listening to tonight. Even if you're just after our sunset safari watching the Juma Dam camera, you might be privy to some incredible lion vocalizations roaring throughout the night. All right, beautiful setting, but Brian and myself are sitting right in the sun. So let's head off. I'm going to go across to Treehouse Dam. While I do that, let's find out whereabouts Brent is and what he's up to. Quick. Fair enough. Poor Brent seems to have gone black screen at that exact moment. So we'll see if we can't sneak up on these warthog instead. Much more nervous than the females and their babies that we've been seeing recently. And I think just while we're looking at warthogs at Twin Dams Road itself, I think it is safe for us to assume, I think it's safe to say that we were correct in assuming that that warthog that the Birmingham boy dug out was in fact that female that we watched for a couple of weeks getting thinner and thinner. She was clearly very ill. When the Birmingham boy pulled the warthog out of the burrow, we weren't 100% sure if it was her, but she used to hang around this area all the time, and I haven't seen her since. I think it is safe to say that that was correct in that assumption. They're also reveling in the amount of greenery and fresh food for them to eat. I don't really know how much animals truly appreciate the taste of the food that they're eating. But the thought, watching them over the past few months eating this dried, grey, brown-looking grass, I can only imagine that it must be such a relief to them. I don't know whether that's just because they know that there's better nutrition, or if they really do appreciate a slight change in diet. I wonder what that warthog's found. It's obviously very chewy. Oh, I thought we had some yellow bulldog pickers, but it's just our... It's our standard red bulled variety poking over the shoulders of these buffalo. Something that I remarked upon recently that I never thought I'd ever do is I've become more and more aware of individual buffalo bulls. I've got to know their identifying characteristics. Look at the three of those oxpeckers riding on the back, beaks wide open, trying to cool down. It's hot work out here on the backs, the steaming backs of the buffalo. I wonder if they're going to have any problem with the warthogs. No. Seem quite at ease with each other. Every now and again, a buffalo gets quite grumpy and chases other animals off for no clear apparent reason. Now, we've spoken a lot about the formation of the pans that these buffalo have been wallowing in. And Nigel was wondering if the soil types are different around a pan. And yes, to an extent, a pan can't or doesn't hold water nearly as well in some places than it does in others. So the best pans are formed within quite clay-like soil. So rather than being coarse and grainy, that the water can just flow away and into the underground water sources. Instead of being coarse and grainy, if it's fine and sandy and quite thick and glutinous once it is wet, that's the best sort of soil for this particular, or for the purposes of a natural waterhole being born. Now, the area that we're in, we're down towards the drainage line, so that automatically the big river system that is known as the Mulwati River System that runs right through the center of Juma. And that will also come with it, with that will also come a whole different type of soil. So yes, different soils throughout the area, crests and basins. And the clay soil is much nicer for the formation of, or much better for the formation of the pan. Okay, it seems as though this time Brent does have signal. So let's try once again to find out what he's up to and where he's going.
Sorry about that, we had a few gremlins and busy on the Bullshook cut line today. toot toot! So what our plan is we're heading down the northern edge of our traverse area. Now, as I started, I'm not sure how much have you got. So Jamie was telling you about those Birmingham males rushing through and chasing off those Salati males during the night. Now, they found two Birminghams in Buffalo's Hook, one in Torchwood. Now, when lions rush off like that, it's quite common in those coalitions that one might just be a little bit more lazy, and he could still be somewhere in this area. So we're just gonna have another double check through and make sure we can, there are no tracks of him, and that he is actually not on our traverse area at the moment. Also, the report of Tingana being in Simbambiri could have forced Mvula to dash this way, and he was hanging around in this particular area before Tingana moved in and chased him off recently. So just having a quick squiz, any lion or leopard tracks that might be about. It's going to be very, very interesting as we head in now into our winter months, our dry season, and you're going to see how green it is and how quickly it's going to get very dry again. Now, before, when we were sort of in the throes of the drought, which we still are, it just doesn't look like it at the moment, we've probably had a quarter of our normal annual rainfall, or our normal sort of summer rainfall from over from November through to about now. So there isn't that much grass. It's very green at the moment, yes, but there isn't actually that much grass around. So it is looking to be a bumper year if you're a predator, and a little bit difficult if you're a herbivore. Now, a lot of people think we should help a lot of the animals, specifically we're going to be seeing some extremely skinny buffalo and kudu and impala and things like that, and they're going to not look well at all. And I know there's a lot of feeling that we should step in, intervene, give them some food, open up more water holes, but drought isn't necessarily a bad thing. Now, what happens with the drought, of course, all your weaker individuals and your individuals and quite often your young individuals will die, but it does give you the best genetic stock that survives. So those populations bounce back quite quickly. The last real major drought that was comparable to the one we're about to go into now was in 1992, and Kruger buffalo population dropped from about 40,000 to 12,000.
Yeah, well, it seems as though Brent's going through a bit of a patchy signal area, but you've arrived at exactly the right time. We're just driving or trundling along towards Treehouse Dan, and I'm checking the drainage line that runs perpendicular to it very, very carefully. It's the perfect place for a leopard to decide to spend the heat of the afternoon. And that is one of the wonderful things about leopards is the fact that they don't necessarily go by the rule book. So even driving around in temperatures like we're experiencing at the moment, there could well still be a leopard that's decided that it wants to be on the move. And I remember with Scott, when Scott was acting as my cameraman, he was sitting in the back, and we actually delayed the start of the sunset safari that particular day. Temperatures were well up over 45 degrees centigrade, so I think that roughly about 106, 107 degrees Fahrenheit, if not more. No, it must be more. So either way, it was a very, very hot day. And we didn't really expect to see all that much out and about. And there was Tingana right in the middle of the road, the big dominant male leopard of the area. Just wandering around. Despite the heat, it just goes to show how whatever books you might read that suggest looking for leopards in the shade and that they don't move around during the heat of the day aren't necessarily 100% accurate. Sure, more buffaloes. Also checking the branches of the trees very, very carefully. That's where I would be. If I were a leopard this afternoon, that is where I would be. I just mentioned about recognizing individual buffalo and the fact that I never thought I'd be able to. I know this one that's staring at us. He's got the flattest horn base. He's got the weirdest base of his horns, or boss as it's officially termed. Look at him, he's so distinctive. It's almost square. And I've seen him everywhere from Cheetah Cutline right across west to Treehouse Dam, which is where we are looking at the moment. And he's always the one that stops and stares at you. Interesting. If somebody had told me months ago that I would be recognizing individual buffalo bulls, I'm not sure I would ever have believed them. Now, there's one buffalo. It's somewhere in this vicinity. And Donna Miller was wondering if I've seen the one with the big open hole on his shoulder. Now, we saw the oxpeckers earlier, and we've spoken a lot before about how beneficial oxpeckers can be to the animals that they sit on and that they pick off the ticks. One oxpecker equals 1,000 ticks per day, which is definitely of tremendous use to the buffalo themselves. But then, of course, there's the flip side of the coin, and that is that if a buffalo has an injury, they will peck and worry at it constantly and prevent it from healing. And Donnie, you were wondering if I've seen that one with the big open hole, and it gets deeper every time I see it on his shoulder. I haven't seen him today. That being said, he likes this area. He likes the area between Treehouse Dam, Philemon's Cutline, and Twin Dams Road, which is where we started our sunset safari. And I would not be at all surprised if he were hiding somewhere. He might even have been in that buffalo sighting we had earlier, because we couldn't see all of them clearly. He might be there. I don't think he's here. It's on his right shoulder, if I remember correctly. So unless it's the one lying down, facing off to the left, and we can only see his left side, I don't think he's here. There we go. There's our... I almost want to name this buffalo with the square boss, the one on the right of your screen. I wonder if any of you can think of a good name for him. He's just so... I can't decide if he's stupid looking or if he's actually quite attractive in a very symmetrical way for a buffalo. I wonder if any of you have any suggestions as to what we could nickname this particular buffalo. I'm going to think about it. He reminds me of somebody. He reminds me of a celebrity without meaning to be insulting, and I can't work out who it is. But he definitely reminds me of someone. Any suggestions you can send through to hashtag Safari Live on Twitter or email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And Rebecca in Final Control, who has just joined the team, and please, nobody out there take offense to this, she's suggested quite possibly Matt Damon. I can sort of see it in his own way. He is quite a pretty buffalo, very symmetrical. He looks younger than the others, and I'm not sure if that's just because he doesn't have as many old injuries, or if there's something about the symmetry of his horns. Now that boss that I'm talking about that he has is probably of a tremendous advantage to him in shape like that. That is solid bone on all buffalo, covered in a keratin sheath, and it's there to absorb the impact of the shock when they fight each other. And just imagine two of these behemoths racing at each other at a speed of at minimum 10 meters per second, 30 feet per second, and then colliding with their heads. Now his boss extends right down towards where his eyebrows would be and down towards his eyes. So in a way, he's actually at an advantage because he's got extra protection for his brain case. But perhaps, as interesting as he looks, there might even be a physiological advantage to having a boss in that shape. Certainly there is a great variety to the shapes of buffalo's horns. That's not something that you want to be at the receiving end of. And he's always a bit more nervous than the others as well. The other buffalo ignore us completely. He seems to be a bit more alert. All right, we can't, as entertaining as they are, don't think we can spend our entire afternoon looking at buffalo bulls. Let's try again and see what's happening, not with the buffalo, but at Buffalo's Hook Dam. It was worth an attempt. Unfortunately, Buffalo's Hook Dam seems to be stymieing us in terms of signal. Buffalo's Hook, of course, meaning Buffalo Corner Dam. I've just seen such a lovely example of a leopard track. I'm sure I just saw that. Otherwise, I am going completely... Oh, I see it again. Let me just move up a little bit so that Brian can. It is. Do you think you can get it from there, Brian? It's right in the center of that, just where the shadow starts. Can you see it there? On the right of the tire tracks, up a little bit. Down a little bit. Down a little bit. Into that patch of sun just below those ant line holes. Down a bit further. There we go. Uh-huh. Perfect. Thank you. Sorry, Brian. Shame. So often we'll say to one of the cameramen, there, and just point it. Don't necessarily know exactly where we mean. That perfect little print.
Good afternoon, mobile station. May I have a route update on where you're set up, please?
I'm not sure how James manages to be so funny on the game drive comms. I'm going to hop out a second. We've been having quite a lot of fun with measuring tracks, and VM has very kindly lent me a pair of calipers, and we've been measuring the tracks. He's lent to me on the condition that I tell him everything that I find. We've measured Tingana's and Mvula's tracks. I never quite got around to measuring Karula's. And I know this was Karula because I saw her walk along this track. So let's try and figure out. Unfortunately, it's only the one track that I've got here. But let's have a look at how big her back left foot is. So everybody get your pens and paper out. Oh, whoops, I forgot about the buffalo. Brian will keep an eye on the buffalo for me. He'll let me know if anything starts to go wrong. And let's get a measurement. Try and move out of your way here. So, Karula's back foot is 8.8 centimeters. That's how big Karula's back foot is. Might not have got it exactly in the place that it was, but it measures exactly 8.8. Compared to Mvula and Tingana's back foot that were about 2 centimeters longer than that. So that is the difference. 2 centimeters being close to about an inch in size. That's the difference between a male and a female leopard track. This is an older track. It's quite, degraded. It's no longer clear at all. But just an interesting little project that I've been attempting to build up some information about. Right, I'm going to continue on. Let's see what else I can find. Let's try once again to find out what Brent's up to.
So we're back, and hopefully, if we don't move, we won't disappear again. So here we go. Two little elephant bulls, but younger than the two we started the sunrise safari with, having a nice little drink at the Buffalo's Hook waterhole. So this waterhole is going to be a very, very important spot, as we've been discussing how dry it's going to get. I don't think it's going to last out the whole dry season, but I think it'll definitely be a very important point on Juma, and we are going to get a lot of activity around this waterhole. We've been chatting about Eddie's quite a bit since we started the safari with them. And Kathy, who's in Long Island, would like to know, how good is an Eddie's hearing and eyesight? Both are excellent, Kathy. There was for a long time a very sort of perceived that elephants had bad eyesight. They don't have bad eyesight. They don't have the best eyesight. They have reasonably good eyesight. But because they've got such super hearing and smell, they tend to utilize those two senses first. But I mean, they can hear rumbles of other elephants from about 20 kilometers away. So unfortunately, they are moving off, and I'm quite scared to move in case we disappear again. We'll just finish that chat about drought while we're here. And one of the animals that's going to be really hard hit by the drought are these old Buffalo Bulls. And I know you've been seeing quite a few of them with Jamie. There's another old retired gentleman sitting in the Buffalo's Hook waterhole. I was saying drought is not always a bad thing. So a lot of the animals that die, the ones that remain, have the strongest genetic code, and therefore they bounce back quite quickly. So for example, buffalo, the buffalo population in the early 1990s when the drought hit, dropped over that space of a drought from about 40,000 to 11,000. But they bounced back really quickly because it was the best of the genetic stock was there. And they bounced back to just under 60,000 this time. And so far in the very dry period we had a few, or month or so ago, in the whole Kruger, only about 900 buffalo died as a direct result from that drought. And so very, very interesting. And quite often what happens, and a lot of people who travel to Kruger, they're, oh, everything's dying. And everything's not dying. Everything at certain waterholes seems to be dead. And also you find the predators on more kills and stuff like that. But we often always tend to micromanage or micro-focus. And 900 buffalo in an area that's bigger than Switzerland, well, it's not such a big loss. Now, even if we had to lose 20,000 buffalo, there's still plenty enough genetic stock for it to get back, and it actually isn't a bad thing. Of course, if you're a farmer, it's horrific, and you wouldn't want to wish a drought on any farmer. But from a wildlife point of view, wildlife populations are designed to deal with this. They've been dealing with disease and drought for a lot longer than we started managing them. And there's a wonderful little saying about us. As often we're gardeners in Eden. We have this perfect, immaculate system that works and is all interconnected, but it doesn't quite suit our thinking. So then we start fiddling and changing and things like that. So we've got to be very careful not to do that. But as I said, the drought's not necessarily a bad thing. And for lions and things like that, the last major drought in the early 90s, the lion populations increased by 20%. So there's always a time of abundance for the predators, but then there's always a time of abundance for the herbivores. And of course, those are going to be different. So we are going to try and move now. I don't know what will happen. Jennifer says she's seen the buffalo lie, urinate, defecate, and chew the cud in the water. But do they drink the water that they do that to? And yes, they do. Look at him. He's about to have a roll. Oh, he looked like he might roll right onto his back, but he stopped there at the last second. He's probably getting attacked by terrapins under the surface of the water, feeding off the ticks on his body. Now, a lot of our long-time viewers will know I'm quite a fan of the wild flowers we get out here. And there are a few that are normally quite common that we haven't actually been able to show you so far this year because of the lack of rain, but they have made a resurgence. And this is one a lot of you might recognize the shape of because it's very similar, especially those who are like gardening. There it is, pretty, pretty little flower. I'm gonna pop it on the dashboard. It's got quite a strong smell and a very unpleasant sort of odor. Take it, yeah, sorry, Vim. Let's have a smell there, Vim. So quite an unpleasant smell, so it's used as an insect repellent, but definitely not the nicest smelling of the insect repellents. Oh, there goes the flower. So I haven't told you what the name is on purpose yet. And if we have a look. So there we go, that's what it looks like more or less. And it looks very similar to a garden plant that is quite sought after. So before I tell you what it is, I think I'm gonna let you guys have a gander at what species it is. Now, I'm sure there's some avid gardeners out there who are going to get this so easily. But if so, if you do know it, drop me an email on questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter to get that through. What plant is that? It looks very similar to a garden plant that I know a lot of people like to keep, but it does have quite a few little different uses. In parts of Zimbabwe, the leaves and the roots are mashed and boiled together with other things and eaten like a spinach, but only when they're a bit desperate because that smell is not very pleasant. Apparently when cooked it's a lot more tasty, but I think just that smell, initial smell, and I'm sure it gives it off when it's cooking, would probably put me off a little bit. Okay, so I'm about to go through a dip, so I don't know what's gonna happen. Fingers crossed.
And back on the back of Wendy once again, and we trundle along looking for he's going to disappear, I think. These impala rams have become a lot more entertaining to watch over the last few weeks or the last few days. And sometimes if you're lucky when you stop, we might get to catch them clay fighting as they have been over the last few weeks as the hormone levels rise. Doesn't look though as though these gentlemen are going to be too interested in that right now. Might be a little bit too hot, to be honest. Far more entertaining to spend time snacking and fighting each other. This bachelor herd, if you look at their horns, all of these males are about 4 years old or older. That's when impala reach the point that their horns have fully grown and have taken on the full adult shape with the curves up at the tips. Now an extraordinarily pretty antelope. All right, don't think our boys are going to do too much. Move on. My other project for this afternoon, depending on what happens, and as you know, drives don't really go according to plan, is I really want to see if I can't find the new hyena den. And I'm sure that that is one of the things that James is going to set out to do this afternoon on tracking team. I'm sure that he's going to attempt to relocate them. I suspect if I had to put money on where I think they are, I would guess they're still around the Aubrey's Road den site. So for those of you who are actually joining us for the first time, we have been watching a clan of spotted hyenas, and in particular, three sets of small cubs, all under the age of 4 months old, 5 months old now. And they've just moved their den site from one termite mound to somewhere else, and we're not 100% sure exactly where they've gone. And it would be really nice to try and find them again. It's interesting, they seem, at that particular, or those particular den sites, they seem to move regularly from place to place to place. Hopefully we can figure out where they've gone to next. I've already checked the old hyena den. So I've checked Philemon's Cutline, I did that yesterday afternoon. James checked Gallagher Shortcut, I checked Mvubu Road Den. The only other den site that I haven't checked that we know of is the one that's just off this road. So I might poke my nose in there this afternoon and see if it looks as though it might be inhabited. When you're looking for an active hyena den, you're looking for a couple of different signs. One is tracks of the adults moving backwards and forwards, and they usually move along the roads just because, like most animals, roads are easier for them to walk down than to walk through the bush, easier and quieter. So they usually use the roads, so their tracks are clearly visible, backwards and forwards. And then you're also looking for fresh scat, but quite far away from that, an anal pasting and a smell. I agree, Donna. Donna feels as though she's going through a hyena withdrawal. I am as well. It's been far... I mean, not that I can complain, because admittedly I've been very much distracted by different leopard sightings and time spent with the lovely Karula. But I am feeling their absence quite sharply at this point, and I would very much like to relocate them. James, of course, as we know, has a gift for finding hyena dens. He's found two in the last few weeks. Fingers crossed he will be able to help us out in that regard as well. And that would be lovely for all of us. It's always special spending time with the spotted hyenas. It feels like you're missing out on part of their lives if they go absent for too long. We'll also be looking for any fresh chewing signs, since all five of those young cubs are at the stage where their sharp little teeth are still coming through. And they might even start, the eldest one, November, might even start properly teething in losing his adult, or losing his puppy teeth, and start growing his adult teeth soon. That happens at around 6 to 8 months. Hopefully we can relocate them once again. Just coming around this area, a couple of days ago, there was water all around here. This is now, this mud wallow is completely dry already. So as Brent was discussing with this drought, we did have some rain and it definitely helped, but it's not going to be a permanent solution, sadly. But that does mean that for our lovely hyena families and for our leopard and our lion cubs, they will all be growing up in a time of proverbial plenty as the predators flourish over the next few months. Pickings become very easy if the animals are all forced around a very limited area. Now, just on the subject of our brand new cubs, and this is going to be a bit tricky. Just for those of you who have missed the update, Cedric from Arethusa found the den site of the Styx female. I'm trying to show you a warthog, but it's so impossibly hidden that I don't think I can. Oh, and it ran away. Oh well, such is life. And it's got little piglets. Oh well, maybe it'll run into a nice open spot. But just that quick update, Cedric found the denning site of a young Styx female, the lioness that was about to pop, and in fact now has. She's had her cubs, and the other two didn't look like they were going to be far behind. I don't know if this is going to be possible, Brian. Every time I think I've got an opening, it's just not quite. Oh well, I guess you've seen warthogs already this afternoon. It's so tempting. It's amazing. This growth in vegetation has just changed the game completely, because the leaves and everything have just suddenly totally obliterated the view into the bush. Back to the lion cubs, and actually to get to the point that I was trying to get to, which is Michael's question. Now, Michael wanted to know, when leopards or lions have cubs, do they have identical twins? And the answer is no, they don't. You might have the odd situation where identical twins are possible. Identical twins, of course, forming from the same fertilized cell that then splits off into two totally separate individuals. But for any leopard and lion that I have encountered, they do look completely different. Individual spot patterns, often different sexes, and incredibly, and I always find this the most fascinating aspect of this entire question, born with totally different personalities. And you can start to see that from the beginning. Some a little bit more shy, a little bit more retiring, others bolder. And it's not necessarily connected to males versus females. There's not a It might be a bit of a stronger correlation with the male cubs being slightly more bold. But that isn't a definite. An interesting question. And I would love to know what governs the way in which animals develop their different personalities. I just got distracted there by a hyena track. I'm gonna go peruse the old hyena den, see if there's any sign of hyena tracks or hyena activity, and let's find out what Brent is up to.
Sorry about that, and we the tech team are actually trying to figure out with their magical computer skills what's happening. So we'll just persevere, soldier on. So we were chatting about, I've made sure, where's it disappeared to? There's the leaves, and there's the flower. So we were chatting about that. And we've got some answers. Oh, Raisa D, Rosie, and many others, well done. It is a wild foxglove. I think I'm gonna have to find a bit of a more difficult flower for you guys. And so it's used in a lot of different traditional medicines. It's used for earache, it's used for diarrhea, it's used for menstrual pains. And it is a very, very interesting. Oh, sorry, I just saw something move at high speed. It was a dike, and it is not stopping. But so, used over a whole lots of different things and in different combinations. So in concoctions of the roots and of the leaves and of the flowers and of the seeds. Now, they always grow in quite sandy areas. So quite often you can actually find sort of groves of them almost, but this year not so many. There are quite a few around now, but not too many. Now the interesting thing about the eating it, as I said, it's used as an insect repellent. It's got this foul smell. There's no other way to describe it. It's a very, I don't even know how to describe it. It's not a very pleasant smell. But they say when you start cooking, that smell disappears and it becomes very sort of mucousy, so like very sticky and snotty, and it's very sweet, and it's got very very high contents of quite a few different vitamins. A and C, and a very high iron content. So it's used often as a vegetable for small children and for invalids. So it's very sweet, so very nice tasting, and as well having very good nutritional properties. So the wild foxglove. The flowers definitely haven't been as good as their normal rainy season. We have seen quite a few of the standards of string of stars, heliotropes, roadside pimpernels, but we haven't been seeing some of those really interesting ones that only flower every couple of years. And I am hoping we do find a couple of new ones to add to the flower list. And I have been checking extensively, but just no luck in chatting about the string of stars, or the lamb's tail. There's a whole host of them growing around. You can see there, VM's gonna show you now. And also the other flower we mentioned quite recently was that the roadside pimpernel, bright red creature. And that is also growing right here. Very convenient, as I was talking about both those species. You got him there, there he is, VM. Just zoom in to the right, a little bit more to the right. A little bit more to the right, a little bit more, there it is. Okay, so it's quite easy to confuse the pimpernel with the lion's eye, which we have seen, I think, one of only or two of this rainy season. So the lion's eye has a much more pronounced sort of orange center, but it's much bigger. But they do, the flowers and the color of the petals is very similar. That's the Trichlicera, or a roadside pimpernel. So what we've done now is there's no tracks of those lions out and about, so we have been looking for tracks of Gejima, the male leopard, He has been in this area, but no track so far. James just called on the radio. He's out tracking, that he's found some leopard tracks way down in the sort of western sectors. So I'm going to start slowly meandering towards there, see if I can give him a hand. Hopefully we can find that cat. I have a sneaky suspicion it might be Imvula trying to avoid Tingana. Go see if we can speed up a little bit, maybe go help James. Oh, there we go, there we go. Did you get that, Vim? You got them there? Okay. Oh, darn it. So a very interesting phenomenon. He's just disappeared there, but we'll try to find some more of them. Steph and I were actually discussing it last night. We had quite a few cuckoos really early on, and they just disappeared. And after this late flush of rain, a lot of the cuckoos have come back. And a lot of the time, we found them feeding on caterpillars, which is one of the cuckoo's favorite foods. So I wonder where they went, and now they've come back. There's still African cuckoo about. There's still common cuckoo or European cuckoo about. There's Levaillance, there's and Jacobin. Are still around. I haven't heard a black cuckoo for a while, and I haven't heard a red-chested cuckoo for a while, but there are quite a lot of cuckoo species, and great spotted I saw the other day as well. So we will try keeping an eye out for some of the cuckoos that have made a comeback, maybe one last gorge on the caterpillars before they have to take their long trip home. That's great news that the Styx lionesses have given birth, and they are using the Mowati River as a den site at the moment. Tammy, who's in Indiana, is wondering how close are they to Shadow and her cubs? Actually quite far, Tammy, probably 4 or 5 kilometers. They're much actually closer to where Karula's den site is. So probably no more than a kilometer from where Karula is keeping her cubs currently. But that is not uncommon. Both lion and leopard can tend to pick similar type of areas. To stash cubs in. So hopefully they don't shadow, Karula doesn't find the lion's cubs and vice versa. Still on the Styx cubs, Doodle's wondering, having all the cubs around the same time, will that be beneficial or will it be detrimental to them? Well, generally it is quite beneficial. So lions are one of the few animals and a few carnivores that practice allosuckling. What that means is that those cubs will be able to suckle off any of those females. So they will tolerate related cubs that aren't their direct sort of sons and daughters, will be able to feed off the other lions in the lionesses in that pride. In terms of protecting them, it doesn't really change too much. So those cubs are going to be kept away from the rest of the pride for a couple of months, until they're generally about 2 months old, before they're going to be introduced into the pride. So that shouldn't make too much of a difference. Now, with hunting, they will leave the cubs somewhere hidden in a drainage line or in a thicket while they go out hunting. Cubs can't go with them hunting all the time. And even when they're older, even up to sort of 8 months, 9 months, they're often left by themselves. So you've noticed that we've definitely had a dip in like zebra sightings and giraffe sightings and things like that. Because of the rain and this green flush of grass, and the animals have spread, but as I said, as it dries up, it's gonna bring these animals back to the permanent waterholes, back to these seep lines around Zoe's Road and around the Mowati River. So we will start seeing those concentrations of animals again. So just in case you guys missed it, I did mention a little bit earlier, but Aileen is wondering what age do they normally bring their cubs back to the pride. As I say, about 2 months is a general rule, sometimes a bit longer, sometimes a bit shorter, but around that 2 months to 3 months. So far, no tracks of big cats, and this is a bit worrying for our streak. We're on 8 days on the trot with a big cat, but nothing this morning, and the pressure's on this evening. Hello, impalalas. Do we have a successful boy, or do we have the group of boys with no girlfriends? No. Group of boys with no girlfriends. Hello, gentlemen. Now, the rut hasn't started in full fettle yet, as these impala are still looking sleek and in great condition. But as the rut continues, you actually watch the bones start appearing on a male impala's body as he is so single-mindedly chasing tail, so to speak. But I'm gonna start moving a little bit quicker, try get into that area where James had tracks, see if I can give him a hand. While we do that, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
Just having a quick sip of water. Important to stay hydrated out here, and it is still very, very warm. Although there's this breeze taking the edge off, and a hint of cloud, just a hint, starting to make an appearance. Maybe those rumors of rain, not completely out of place. Generally gets very, very warm here before it rains. The cold fronts push the heat ahead of them. And we get those really hot afternoons, and then all of a sudden it breaks overnight. Hopefully a bit of cloud cover on its way. Help to keep the water around just that little bit longer. There's a specific plant I'm looking for. I want to try something. There's a plant called a bushman's grape, and it's used that you can crush the leaves and put them on a bee sting, and it's got quite a nice antihistamine soothing effect. I want to see if I can find it. I've decided. Now, with all the rain, we've got the flies back out, we've got the mosquitoes back out, and of course, naturally, we've got the ticks out as well. And for some reason, I appear to be something of a tick magnet, and I've walked through, once again, another nest of those pepper tick mites. Those tiny, tiny, tiny little pepper ticks that look like freckles. And of course, particularly for me, with my pale freckled skin, they do tend to remain unnoticed until they've managed to have a jolly good meal and drop off. And I do want to test. I've tried everything medicinally with pepper tick bites. I have tried anthazan cream, I have tried antiseptic, I've tried peroxide, I've tried a lot of the suggestions that some of you guys sent through as well to try and reduce the itch, and none of them have worked. I really just want to see if maybe this Bushman's grape might not be the next step in my treatment of tick bites. I think I'm in slightly the wrong area though. I've seen a lot of them around quarantine side. So possibly I'll keep my eyes peeled. So if you see me diving off a vehicle and gathering some leaves, that's what I'm going to test. Just standing by.
What are you checking up?
I'm on Zoe's Road. I think I'm going to go and check around Gallagher Pan and Boo Boo Side.
Okay, copy. I'm going to head towards the Gallagher Pan. I changed his outfit on the track there. Let's see if I can come out.
Okay, copy. I didn't hear him call those in. What tracks has he got there?
Male leopard. Still on top of the stuff from last night. So, let me go have a look.
Copy. Apparently, James has found some male leopard tracks. He's gone for a bit of a walk around. Last time James went walking in that area, this was when he found Tingana on the Warthog Kill. Hopefully we get a repeat of that. Last I heard, Tingana was on Simbambili. But as I said, or as I mentioned earlier, leopards can wander and cover enormous distances when they want to. We had Karula the other day walking from Treehouse Dam to her Inyala Kill. And she covered, I think that might be the tree that I was looking for. Bear with me one moment. It's a new tree for me. It's one that I've only learnt about recently, a new bush. I want to see if this is it and if it works. No, this is just a coppiced plant that's been eaten by elephants and then grown up in separate shoots and stems. Not the tree I'm looking for. The search continues for my medicinal test. I'm going to conduct a scientific test and try and rub it on certain tick bites and not others and see if it enhances the natural healing process or acts as an anti-itching device. See if we can't find some around Gallagher Pan. Speaking a little bit about the temperature and the fact that it's still very, very warm for this late in summer, Kathy was wondering, how hot does it get in the middle of the day in the middle of winter? And Kathy, the answer to that is it still gets very warm. It can get up to 30 degrees, which is 86 Fahrenheit. Usually it sits around, I would say, 24, 25. On your average winter day. I mean, we still end up in shorts and a t-shirt. We could still end up in shorts and a t-shirt in the middle of the day. Not so much me, but I have a very strange thermostat. I get cold very, very easily. And what is that? That's 70, that's around the mid-70s in Fahrenheit would be the normal winter temperature. It's only really in the mornings and the late evenings that it starts to get particularly chilly. And it's the interesting thing about South Africans. Somehow when we construct our houses, we completely forget that there is a cold time of year. I don't know what it is, but somehow most South African houses are built for summer, wonderful in summer, but don't really retain the heat in winter. Now the cold is coming. The layers will be starting. I'm already wearing a jacket in the morning. Soon that will progress to two jerseys and a jacket, plus a scarf and some beanies, possibly two beanies, a hat, gloves, all kinds of things. And on the coldest mornings, a hot water bottle tucked into my jacket also helps. I am an absolute wuss when it comes to cold. I really can't handle it all that well. Brian, you also don't like the cold very much.
Well.
Yeah, I'm a bit of a wimp. Brian and myself are both wimps when it comes to the cold. Bearing in mind that Brian, as the cameraman, has to sit up on the back, so he's even more elevated than I am. And that wind chill factor as you drive along probably drops the temperature by about 5 degrees centigrade below what it actually is. So it drops it easily 10 degrees Fahrenheit. Oh no, my medicinal testing idea is proving to be more tricky than I thought. I know where there is one, but it's very far away from where I am now. Oh well, it was a nice idea while it lasted. I'll keep looking. There must be medicinal plants in the States as well, or around the globe. There we go. Marion's got a suggestion about using the African potato cream. I don't know where I might find some of that, Marion, but I'll definitely keep an eye out for it. I'm open to any and all suggestions on this front. Things are desperate enough that I am, you know, when you wake up in the middle of the night trying to claw your skin off, it really is a little bit much or a little bit excessive. So I'm willing to take any measures. What I was wondering about was whether or not our viewers across the world, and we do have such a wide variety of viewers, have actually tried and found local remedies from trees and bushes and flowers, etc., that have helped things like itchy bites. I remember lots of you sending through your suggestions very kindly on emails that I've since tested. And whilst they were wonderful suggestions and probably would have worked for anything else, for my tick bites, they seem to be fairly resilient. An African potato is out here a plant with all kinds of famous medicinal uses. It is thought to be, it is a very nutrient-rich food type. I don't know what the plant looks like above ground. Obviously, it does grow below the surface and it grows in a tuber-like form, just like a normal potato. But it's one that is particularly valued in local medicinal uses, from anything for colds and flus to hangovers to even the more serious illnesses like tuberculosis. It's put forward as a traditional treatment for those kinds of diseases. And whilst it doesn't seem to have the most tremendous medicinal properties, it most definitely does have very, very high nutrient content. I should have looked into more different types of trees that I could potentially use. I know that marula tree bark is also meant to have antihistamine properties, but I'm not sure how one goes about preparing that. It has to be the cambium layer, so not the hard outside part of the bark. Hello, gorgeous. Aww. They're so shy. It's all right, little bush buck. It's a little antelope species that we hardly ever get to see. I'm hoping it might come out around the side of this bush. Shame she got a bit of a fright. They're one of my favorite, if not my favorite, antelope species here. I think they might actually be my favorite. You're gonna come out this side, girl? I can't even see her anymore. Oh, I can. Shame. She's watching me. Can you see the tips of her ears there? Might get a flash of movement every now and again. She's there. I promise. She's hiding there. Come on, girl. Might be pushing it a little bit. She doesn't seem to want to come out. I was hoping if we sat patiently, she might decide to emerge. The reserve that I used to work at had very thick, dense, riverine vegetation, very rivers that flowed almost the year round. It was the perfect habitat for bushbuck. And during one particular section, we were doing a river cleanup, so moving through the river and finding any bits of debris that had flooded down from upstream. In, I think it was 2013, might have been 2014, those floods. I still see you, girl, come on. It's okay. But in that particular area, I counted 10 bushbuck in a kilometer stretch of river, including a baby that got such a fright when I walked past that it just sat and watched, it hid and watched me. And I was standing about 3 meters from it, 9 feet away from it, just watching this little thing. Oh, she's... Yes, there we go. Aww. Okay, I think I might be... I think I might be fighting a losing battle here. I don't know that she's going to come out. We'll have to wait for another suitable bushbuck sighting. Gilly, which way are you going to go? You're just going to go further in. Almost I feel quite determined to try and get her now that we've spent all this time waiting. No. All right. Okay. Oh, there we go. I've got a bit of a view of her. Very similar shape to an Inyala, but much smaller. Oh, there she goes. Without those white stripes. And you can see she's walking with a much more comfortable stride now that she knows she's got the protection of the dense vegetation around her. In terms of telling the difference between bushbuck and Inyala, bushbuck don't quite have the orangey tint to their coats in the same way the female Inyala do. They are much smaller and not nearly as striped. I have actually seen one or two bushbuck with stripes, but for the most part, the dominant markings that you see is the spots around their rump, white spots around their rump. That's what you're looking for in terms of, it's one of the biggest confusions with people who visit Africa for the first time. They get confused between kudu, Inyala and bushbuck, which are all part of the same family and all look very similar shapes with those large radar dish ears and long, elegant, thin legs. And they all prefer that same vegetation, thick vegetation type. So kudu, large and striped and slightly more grain color. Inyala, in the sort of the middle-sized antelope of the three, with stripes, very vivid white stripes, and then the occasional dot on their rump, and then bushbuck, the smallest of them, with the dots around the rump and no real stripes. Maybe we'll get a chance to have a look and see if we can spot more bushbuck for you, possibly a little bit of a better view. I'm slowly meandering across towards where the old hyena den was, just to see if we can't check there and figure out where they've moved from there. While I do that, jump on the back of the vehicle with Brent.
So, the cat hunt is on. We got just down here. I just spotted James. We just had a chat. He's walking around. But there we go. Male leopard tracks. So what we're going to do is we're going to go check out the boundary road between Arethusa and Juma. See if they've crossed there. And if they haven't, then we will come back to this area. And I might take a little stroll into the bush. See if I can pull a cat out by the tail. So these tracks are from, I would guess, early this morning, so not too fresh, but it has been quite a hot day. So what we're hoping is that he stopped somewhere and he has slept somewhere in this thicket. Hopefully, I'm really hoping he's in this area here and he hasn't gone off towards Arethusa, because if he's crossed towards Arethusa, that particular area of Arethusa is nigh impossible with lots of very steep little riverbeds and that, so quite difficult to get in and out of. Go. Last tracks James said were around here. There they are. There we go. That's where he crosses out there. Okay. So it does seem definitely to be going this way from that track there that's been stood on. Let's just give me 1 second to have a quick look. I want to look a little bit further. Okay, there he is. So it's not going to be a scent marking male, so he probably wouldn't have stopped there. Might have jigged around there. But let's just have a quick check. I was going to check Impala. I'm sorry, Impala Plains on the boundary, but my gut is telling me to go this way. And quite often. Listening to your gut is an important thing when it comes to finding animals. And always check that big tree out there. We have found shadows sleeping in it before. I've had Tingana underneath it before, so we always have a quick squiz. Now, of course, with this rain, the one thing it has done is this wonderful, beautiful green flush has made the spotting a little bit more difficult. So my plan is I'm going to go all the way through to Vuyatela main access, and then only then will I hit the boundary road if I don't find any tracks popping out here. So I'm just going to check down the road quickly, and especially if he was walking in the early morning, there's a lot of dew about, and leopards aren't particularly fond of having dew in their faces and on their paws, so you quite often find them utilizing the roads quite heavily. But obviously the dew is all gone now, so it's very possible that he could be somewhere in this block. So it's up to Vim and I to keep the leopard run or the big cat streak going. Fingers crossed we're able to do that. Otherwise, we have to start again tomorrow. So if we don't have any luck now, that's not the end of the world. Not the biggest train smash. So we're going to check, and we'll check around, make sure there's no tracks crossing out over the boundary road. But the trick is now, if we can't find any tracks, and if I don't manage to find them on foot, we definitely want to be in this area as the sun starts going down, when he's most likely to start getting mobile. Often putting yourself in the right place, in the right area to hear an alarm call, and will definitely aid in your search for big cats and other predators. Hey guys, one second. Afternoon, Andrew. No updates for the north, just in Konzo, Wanuna Ingwe, around Balanites, Impala Plains. I'm following up. Sorry guys, be with you in a second. Last truck I could see was heading into the block between power lines and Impala Road. I'm just gonna go around and check Triple M to make sure they haven't crossed out. Tingana was located in Sibambili, but these are not the same set of tracks. I think this could be Mvula. But I'm gonna check Triple M now, and then I'm gonna head back and go for a walk. Okay, copy. Thanks very much. Sorry, I was just listening to Andrew there. Apparently, this is a nice kudu. Oh no, don't run away. You've got a heartbeat. Oh, yeah. Kudu is not agreeing with us. There, he's disappeared, a young male. See if we catch another glimpse. You see him, Vim? Oh no, he's gone into the thickets. He's a bit camera shy today. Sensational, saying, well, if a leopard's a leopard, what is a panther? A panther. Oh. Sorry, guys, one second. The game drive just got very busy. Okay, sorry about that. Just making sure I didn't miss an update there. But Sensational was asking, if a leopard's a leopard, what is a panther? Sorry about that. They're being very, very noisy. A panther is a leopard. So a panther is a melanistic leopard. Sometimes also jaguars are called panthers, but it is a black jaguar or a black leopard, more commonly a black leopard. And basically that is just a double recessive gene that causes the darker sort of coloration in animals to come through. So called menilism. So a panther is generally a menilistic leopard. So if you look carefully, if you can find any photographs online and you have a look at them, you can actually still see the rosettes. They just don't stick out as much because of that high proportion of melanin they have in their fur. So there we go. So for example, a great panther would be Bagheera from the Jungle Book, but he is a black leopard, which has been referred to as a black panther. So it's not another species at all. It's just a color morph or color variation. So I'm just gonna jump on to the Arethusa channel, see if there's any updates on that side. Afternoon stations in the west, Brent from the north, any updates for Safari Indaba? Nope, nothing happening in the western sectors. Let's stick to our plan. Let's stick on these tracks and see if we get some luck. And there comes James, accompanied by some of the tech team and Jamie's little brother. Sorry, I was just listening again. The Inkahumas weren't too far away. I might just check back up that way shortly. I might just need to get to a bit higher ground to utilize this radio properly. Okay, so while we try deal with these radio comms, let's jump back on with Jamie.
We've arrived at Sydney's Dam. Just to have a look and see what's happening here, or if there's any sign of maybe the Inkahumas deciding to wander back in this direction. Or you never know. Last time I spent some time here, there was a pack of wild dogs that suddenly, miraculously, came racing over the back of the dam wall. One can but hope. At the moment, however, there's just a hippo. And it looks like just one lone hippo, a large bull, and some waterbuck, our sort of standard waterbuck herd that we see around Sydney's Dam whenever we come here. They've got lots and lots of little youngsters with them. Look at them all clustered there, the babies at the back. This seems to be their favorite corner. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 11, 12, 13. That looks about right. Definitely one of the largest waterbuck herds out here. You can see the two big males in the center of your screen there. He turned his head. The emblem of the Sabi Sands Game Reserve. The silhouette of a waterbuck, a male waterbuck. Lovely to see them all together like this. Spoken before about why I enjoy visiting Sydney's dam so much. We don't always get to get this sort of overview of the animals from a distance in nice open clearings like this. We can't drive on Buffalo's Hook, and that's where Sydney's dam is, so we can't drive and investigate it any closer, but it's still been an exceptionally productive dam in terms of game viewing. It's one of the largest dams in our area that we can see, with those females on the dam wall having a bit of a personal space problem. But yes, it's one of the largest dams, which means that there's plenty of animals that move through here. And usually our big buffalo herd sightings occur around this dam as well. More water buck. Sure. And it's particularly beautiful in this afternoon light. My mistake, there's two hippo. And apparently there are also about three crocodiles, at least, in this dam. It also gives us a good opportunity to just stop and listen to the sounds of the bush. It's always nice for us because we've got the constant drone of the engine, and it does mean that you can occasionally miss any kind of alarm calls or anything that might alert you to the movement of big predators. It's always a good idea to stop and just allow time for listening. The last time I went out on tracking team with Steph, we stopped to listen at Sydney's dam, and Karula came striding past right in front of the car. We had no idea she was there. Not much happening here though. No alarm calls. We'll do a loop around Sandy Patch and then up towards Aubrey's Road. And now that it's a bit cooler, I can start my investigations of the hyena den. See if we can't figure out what's happening there. Speaking about our hyenas, Josh in Washington, Josh was wondering, would it be difficult to move a hyena den with the various cubs of the different ages all in tow? I will say, Josh, that it must be a highly entertaining thing to witness, because those cubs are now, I actually almost feel as though it would have been easier when they were a bit younger, because although they are far more mobile at the moment, at this age, they are far more mobile. Which means that they have to keep a really strict control over them. Because it's a dangerous thing, moving cubs a large distance away without any safe bolt holes to disappear into. We've seen it with Madam, the matriarch, and her cubs. We had a sighting with them a couple of days ago where the cubs were getting so brave, they just kept moving further and further away from the den, and she was getting so cross with them. And eventually she grabbed one of them by the back of the neck and actually held it down with its face in the dirt as if to discipline it. And it was incredible to witness that interaction because it was so clearly relatable in human terms as to what she was trying to do. And you could sense her frustration with her wayward cubs. So I imagine that, yes, it would be quite interesting watching the hyenas move. I would also be fascinated to know if they moved the cubs all together or if individual mothers moved their cubs at different times or spaced it out a little bit. I'm not sure which would be the best approach. I think probably safety in numbers would probably be the way to go. If your mother's moving a group of noisy cubs, and cubs also, when they are moved or disturbed or when they cross about something, they give off that high-pitched squealing sound, which could very easily give their position away and attract the unwanted attention of any other big predator moving in the area. Maybe, and I wouldn't put it past hyenas to be this intelligent, maybe the moms go ahead first and double check the pathway and have a jolly good sniff to see if whether or not there's a potential predator there first. beautiful bird. A southern white-crowned shrike. One of the largest members of the shrike family. Stunning in this afternoon light. James just trying to get hold of me. Standing by.
What is your route from Sydney's Dangween?
I will be taking Sandy Patch and then north on Aubrey's. See if I can't find the hyenas.
Okay, got it.
Keeping a very sharp eye out for potential insect prey.
I'm going from the west, tracks and corners heading east, to the east, because I'm really down. I don't know what's managed to relocate yet. I'm still a little bit far from my boundary.
That's just an update. Franklin demonstrating their usual good timing in terms of whenever I'm mid-sentence, they seem to always manage, or I always manage to talk when the Franklins want to talk. It is, of course, their home, so it's me who's interrupting them and not the other way around. Oh, now you choose to go silent. It's amazing when you get that screeching contact call, how it is, there you go, echoed by all the other crested Franklin in the area. It's like a very noisy marketplace with them shouting across the roads to each other. I'd love to know what they're saying, because it's not as though they then immediately race to go and meet up with the other Franklin. It's just a sort of a general announcement. Oh. I can't help it. I always find them hugely comical birds. I don't know what it is. I think it's that. That run across the road. It's that funny little sprint. We saw a couple of them the other day with the mating Birmingham boy and Kahuma lioness. And these Franklin emerged out of the bushes and didn't spot the lion until they were basically on top of it. And the panic in that run as they sprinted past was absolutely hilarious. I was distracted by the Franklin shouting, but I was going to chat a little bit about birds and their eyesight. Did you sneak? Was there a sneaky appearance there?
Was a
there was a sneaky appearance. Well done, Brian. Sorry, they're all shouting now. But yes, this is the first time actually that I've been out with Brian on drive. He is back from leave and Thumb will be making appearances once again. Who knows from one day to the next which character the Thumb might decide to dress up as this time. It was so funny because I missed that completely. I was so distracted. And I just looked back and there's a big grin on Brian's face. Back to bird's eyesight. Just the road I was going down next. Their eyesight makes owls look positively pathetic in comparison. So even a pigeon or a dove sees in a far higher frame rate. I think we see in something like 30 frames per second, and a bird sees far, far more than that. It's almost like they see in slow motion. And that's what gives them that incredible ability to sit so high up in a tree and spot the movement of something as tiny or as nondescript as a grasshopper leaping across from grass blade to grass blade. For this plant. Now that I've mentioned Bushman's grape, I can't seem to find one of them. Oh. It's speaking of the mystery or the mystery Bushman's grape that I'm trying to find to put on. Oh, and just to clarify, an itchy bite. Bite, B-I-T-E. My apologies for the South African accent and the slight miscommunication that may or may not have occurred and for some certain viewers. But Debbie, you were wondering if there's any trees, on the subject of trees, any trees that break down protein. And I'm just trying to think. There are trees that have a very special relationship with bacteria in order to make protein utilizable. There we go. On the log there. Dashing away from us. Little dwarf mongoose. One of my favorite animals to stop and have a look at. Unfortunately, it seems as though Brent has managed to make off with the medicinal tree book. While I'm trying to think of the answer to Debbie's question, I'll get back to you, Debbie. I'm just trying to think of any particular examples. This morning when I drove through here, well, I started off initially with signal issues. I was just about to say, I've never seen as many starlings as I have in this area. There's just these enormous flocks of them. It's something that you see regularly in Kruger. Awesome, well done, Brian. And yet for some reason they've chosen to gather around this particular part of Juma on the main access road. And I must have seen a flock of about 50, which is unusual. You sort of see starlings in groups of twos or threes, not in massive flocks. I'm uncertain what has caused that, or why they're all together in this area. There must be a certain type of food that they're all enjoying. Our dwarf mongoose have now disappeared, it seems. They've gone to ground. And so we come back to Debbie's question about the trees that break down protein. And Debbie, I can't think of one. I can't think of a tree that could. For some reason, my mind, when you asked that question, immediately jumped to treatment for snake venom. And whilst there are lots of different plants that are thought to be effective treatments of snake bites, and a snake venom, of course, is protein. It's a type of protein. So it breaks down naturally on its own. The only thing I can think of is something highly acidic that might act to break down proteins, since acid does denature them, changes the shape of the protein molecule. But beyond that, I can't think of a particular tree that is useful. I'll think about it, Debbie. Nothing's springing to mind straight away. And while I think about that, Brent has got something far larger than the dwarf mongoose we were just looking at, so let's have a look.
So we've caught up with an old friend, and he seems behaving at the moment. Now, this is the hole-in-the-ear elephant, who had to teach some lessons a few weeks ago. And he has been far better since then, far more relaxed. He hasn't really threatened too many of the vehicles since we had our little discussion. Trying to see if he's still in must. I haven't been able to see yet, but I did see that he's still very much in must. Hello, big boy. He is such a magnificent specimen. Now, you can see the dripping from the penile sheath. Sure sign he's in must. Where we're sitting at the moment, we can't smell the musty odor of a big yeti bull. He's just took the tip off that little acacia, and now moving on to a sickle bush. There we go, you can see that hole quite nicely. But if he does start trying to move too close to us, we will move away. But you can just see his whole general body language and demeanor. He's not coming close to us. He's not actively seeking out the car. He's just slowly moving through, feeding as he goes. Remember, always let the car run for a few seconds before you move. Just don't want to teach him to associate the sound of the vehicles with something to chase. Yeah, that's where he's going to pop out into the open shortly. There we go. Now, elephants are incredibly large animals. He probably weighs over 6 tons, so over 6,000 kilograms. So a massive animal. Now, being a massive animal, everything about you is quite big. He's feeding off a large fruited bush willow at the moment. And as I was just saying, how big they are, but everything in them is quite big, so even their noses and their teeth can be quite large, but their heart, which Debbie is wondering about, and a big bull can be up to about 30 kilograms. So massive. Lovely late afternoon light. We're not going to try to push him. We know he does have a little bit of a naughty streak, but hopefully he has decided to stop being the naughty elephant. That tail swinging to keep the flies away. Oh, he's going to move off into the thickets there, and we're going to leave him be.
You've arrived on the back of our vehicle at a really good time. We've just come through to the Aubrey's Road Den. Well, we've come through to Aubrey's Road. And now we play a game of, if you were a hyena, which termite mound would you choose to be in? If, that's of course, if they are still in this area. It's a tricky one because I'm noticing for the first time, this is the first time today that I've driven this road, and I'm not seeing any fresh hyena tracks. Which is not ideal. As I said, hyenas like to use roads. They regularly use roads into and out of the den site. Ah, somebody's had a very similar idea. Station on Aubrey's Road for Jamie. Not have had a radio on. Couldn't see exactly who that was, but they didn't call in the hyena den. We'll check just in case it is active. And Amy would like to know, and it's something that always fascinates me, the history of the names of the roads, and in particular, if Aubrey's Road is named for the fellow guide, a guide that works for Juma, or works on Juma, whose name is Aubrey. Yes, it is, as far as I know. It is the same Aubrey. I would love to know the exact history, why this particular road, if it was a random choice, or if he specifically found a sighting. You might even find, everybody watch your heads, duck out of the way of the leaves. You might even find that Aubrey made that road. That's also a possibility. Reserves do need to have, or do often add to their road networks. Ingwe Alley is the perfect example. It's one of the roads that's been created and called Ingwe Alley because of all the ingwe, or leopard, sightings that have been there. So really good question. I'm actually going to ask Aubrey about the history behind that name, find out exactly what it was that caused this particular road to be named for him. Sure. All quiet, very quiet, but there are fresh tracks around this area, as there were the last time I visited. Isn't it like looking at a different den site? I mean, it's incredible, the amount of grass cover, the inflorescences of the grass that have popped up in the last 2 weeks. Look at them all shining in the sun. I'm completely taken aback. I really thought it was just that little bit too late for the grasses to produce their reproductive parts. That's, of course, what these inflorescences are. It's the reproductive part of the plant, releases their pollen, and they fertilized in a completely different way to the very pretty flowers that Brent has been quizzing you on. They're pollinated by wind rather than by insect action. So they don't need to be brightly colored, they just need to be well tufted to release those seeds into the air. So their seed dispersal method is slightly different. Rather than producing fruits like trees, they will have either sticky burrs or sticky seeds that will attach themselves to the fur of the animal. I'm trying to look for a nice example here. This might be a good one. Oh, my goodness. I'm all falling out here. This is quite a nice example of just the way that the seeds are dispersed by what looks like it would be wind action. Oh, no, the seeds do have little spurs on them. Hoof and wind action would be part of this particular grass's dispersal mechanism. I wish I hadn't done that to my back. I didn't appreciate that reach at all. Beautiful. Now, just while we're here, Trevor wants to know about the most common species of trees. Now, this is the perfect example of one of the most common tree species. It's known as a red bush willow. And actually, if we had to define this particular area, we'd probably define it as mixed bush willow woodland. Lots and lots of different species, but the red bush willow with its twist at the end of each leaf is a very clear example, or a very common tree, Combretum apiculatum. So the Combretum species are one of the most common. There's also the silver cluster leaf, which is just here, also particularly prevalent around drainage line and named for the slight silvery sheen that it has to its leaves and that deeply fissured bark. And on these crests, acacias and marula trees, also exceptionally common. And then once you get down further, it depends on your soil type. Obviously, soil is where everything starts off. The soil type determines the type of grass, the type of trees, and that in turn determines what particular animal species you're going to find there. I was hoping it might mean hyenas. I'm going to do a little bit of an exploration of this area because there's so many fresh hyena tracks around here. It makes me think that they're still hiding here. While I do that, let's find out how Brent's tracking is going.
So, VM and I have not given up on the search for a big cat to keep our cat streak going. unfortunately, those leopard tracks we had earlier went south across our traverse here. So what we're going to do is we're going to head way south, and we're going to hope for a little bit of lady luck to be on our side. And we're going to be hoping Karula might be moving back from the south, moving up to the north to hunt, or even better, moving back to the north with a cub or two. Wouldn't that be spectacular? So, what is the day today? Today is April Fool's Day, and fortunately, no one caught me with any pranks today. But hopefully Karula will not make an April Fool of us, and she will return to be the joker in our pack of cards. So we know with Karula's current cubs, we have the incredible thing. We actually know the exact date they were born. Now, normally, this is really unusual with leopards, and you sort of guesstimate somewhere in that month and you go, okay, let's make her birthday that day, or his birthday that day. But now with Karula's cubs, we actually know the exact date they were born. We saw them when they were less than sort of 8 hours, 9 hours old. How incredible is that? So, they will be 2 months old tomorrow. So they have reached that magical age where we will definitely start viewing them, start the acclimatization process to the vehicles. Very exciting. I know all of you guys out there can't wait, neither can I. And it's going to be spectacular to spend some time with some little cubs. So quite often when we're chatting on the radio or whatnot, you might hear the word Ingwe come up. And spirit in the sky is wondering, what does that mean? Is it a name? It is actually, it's a word. It is a name and it's a word. It is the name in Shangaan for a leopard. So if you hear me say, Inkonzo of Wanuna Ingwe, it is the tracks of a male leopard. If you hear me say, Inkonzo Wansati, it's the tracks of a female. Now, quite often, and what's happened in the guiding industry in this part of the world, suicidal squirrels out there today. And this is the second one who's tried to leap under our vehicle. And fortunately, we just see them and slow down enough. But there it is, the suicidal tree squirrel. Yep, off it goes. So in the guiding fraternity in this part of the world, a lot of the white guides sometimes struggle a little bit with African languages, and they can be quite difficult. So Zulu is probably one of the more widely spoken African languages in South Africa. So a lot of the words that are used on the radio are actually not correct Shangaan, they are Zulu. And for me, the funniest one is that everyone And for me, the funniest is that all the black guys know that it's wrong, but it's just been done for so long that it carries on. So you often get people calling in my daughter Ingwe or my Fazi Ingwe. Now, it is impossible to have a my daughter Ingwe, which basically means male human leopard, or a my Fazi Ingwe, which means female human leopard. So. The correct Shangaan is Wansati and Wanuna for female and male. So chatting about babies and cubs and things, Rumei, who's in Illinois, is wondering which female animal is the best mother? And that's a very interesting question. Now, one would probably have to think about it a little bit. And we know it's probably not lions and leopards. They're definitely not the best. What have we got there, Liam? It is an animal of some kind, I think. What is it? Ah, it is a buffalo. But we'll get a bit closer then. So it's quite an interesting question, because with most females or mothers, they will happily sacrifice their babies in most cases to save themselves under the sort of guise that they are going to be able to mate again, they'll be able to produce more babies. But if they die, that's the end of their genetic line. Well, it's a group of buffalo bulls. So moving away from the little drainage lines. Oh, it's Liam's favorite buffalo, the one who has a very silly look on his face. Oh, he's getting a little bit of a wrestle going there. He's got that funny big boss that seems to come over his eyes and gives him a very bemused and befuddled look. Look at that. Now, he definitely does not look like a clever buffalo. Not a clever-looking buffalo. He's also quite a small-bodied buffalo. You can see he's being bullied by the others. And so they've moved away from the drainage lines and pans, and they're heading up on top of onto the top of the crests. So it's going to be slightly warmer as it cools down up on top here. And let's leave them moving off. They're going to find a nice spot to sit down and sleep off the evening and chew the cud. But well, back to Rumei's question. And, well, Rumei, so a lot of animals, lion and leopard included, so probably it's not only the mother but the whole system that cares the most or tries to care the best for their offspring would probably be African wild dogs. So they're one of the only animals where the pups are higher on the social ranking than the adults, and which makes them quite similar to people, strangely enough, in that regard. Definitely a little bit more smelly than people, or some people at least. So we're going to go right to the southwestern corner, and then we're going to head east down the southern boundary at the off chance at this time of the day the leopards are likely to get moving and that Karula might start heading north. Let's go see what Jamie and how her hunt for her hyena den is going, and we're going to speed off to get to that spot where I want to start checking for Karula's tracks.
I'm sad to report that my hunt for the hyena den has not gone according to plan. I've checked all of the old den sites that I can on within this Aubrey's Road block by following the old road into them. No sign of any cub tracks, no sign of any hyena moving through that area. I still have a suspicion that they are there somewhere, though, and I think it's going to take quite a lot of time on foot moving between possible den sites and investigating each and every termite mound. I think that will be a project for me tomorrow morning whilst out on tracking team. Being distracted by tracks. It's not, however, hyena tracks, which I was hoping for. But I don't actually know. I don't know what these tracks are. It's an interesting experience. I usually guess relatively quickly. That's very interesting. I'm going to try, I'll try to pull off the road so I can show you what they are, what they look like and how big they are. And let me see if I can't work this one out. How's your view from there, Brian? I'm looking at all of these little toes. My first thought as I was driving past was that it had to be monkeys. And I still think that it has to be monkeys. They just look a little bit peculiar. I'm going to jump out and just have a closer look. Not all that often that we encounter tracks that we can't tell which particular animal we're looking at. I do think it is monkey. I think it's just the way that the light was catching them and the fact that their baby is walking along with them. So vervet monkey tracks. Sorry, just listening to elephants far away. Vervet monkey tracks are like little hands, but so you can see the tiny, we might be able to see the tiny, tiny little toes over here. And then the back of the track is quite sharp. It almost forms a V shape. It's much more narrow at the back than our hands, for example, would be. And that is complete in complete contrast to a baboon track, which is obviously the only other similar primate-like track that you would find on the ground like this. Their tracks really do look like human hands, slightly more squat, but you can see all five fingers, and they've got a very square back to the shape of the track. I think this is a troop of monkeys walking down the road. They just had me confused for a second, the way that they've fallen in the dirt and the way that the light was striking them. And they've got babies with them as well, because there's definitely some very tiny, tiny little tracks. Now, a couple of drives ago, Janine, one of our viewers, actually suggested making that she's going to screenshot all the different tracks that she sees and start similar to the bird list that we always encourage our viewers to work on. She said she's going to start a track list with screenshots accompanying them so that she will be able to refer back whenever she comes across or whenever we look at different tracks. And we started off with a tortoise track moving across the road, and I promised her antelope tracks, but Janine, just let me know if you are watching or if you're not, so that I can find you the antelope tracks that we see regularly. And I've encouraged a lot of the other, all of you, if you find yourself so inclined, if you find yourself as fascinated by the process of tracking as I do, and it really is, it's like, I often compare it to almost reading the newspaper of the bush. The animals have left all the signs behind, it's just up to us to find a way of reading and interpreting them. And you can learn a huge amount about animal behavior just through tracking alone. And vice versa, you can learn a lot about tracks by watching animal behavior and then going up behind them and having a look at the tracks that they've left behind during that whole process. But there's no hyena tracks on this road. So where on earth have the hyenas decided to go? Speaking a bit about the monkey tracks and then the possible differences or the differences with baboon tracks, Red was wondering if there are any baboons around the area. Interestingly enough, there has been a troop that Brent and myself spent some time following the tracks of a couple of days ago. We hardly ever see baboons here at the moment, and I think that's largely due to the drought that we've experienced. They've moved further towards the larger river systems, place where they can have better access to fruit and the trees are in slightly better condition. So Red, we haven't seen any, I personally haven't managed to get any on our live shows since we started. They occasionally make an appearance at the Juma Dam and therefore on the Juma Dam camera. And I know that there was a troop of baboons that were very regularly seen by viewers watching it a couple of years ago. They were known as the Gowrie Gang, and they were always around. It's just interesting the way that animal movements ebb and flow in that way, that we've got to the point now where we just hardly ever see them. And I've seen them, in the time that I've been working here, I've seen their tracks moving through the reserve probably less than 10 times. And I've seen them once when they came to have a drink from the swimming pool outside my bedroom. Those are the only times I've seen baboons. But yet they are here, they naturally occur here. Went to visit some friends across at Simbambili a couple of nights ago, and I heard the baboons calling from the trees around their dam. And they are about. They just haven't made it across to Juma yet. Or at the they have decided not to be around Juma at the moment. It's awesome to hear from James Richard on the subject of our mystery tracks that nearly had me fooled. Obviously, I wasn't thinking clearly enough, but James Richard's been keeping a track scrapbook, a collection of the different tracks that we stop and show you. And I really must, when the light's a little bit better, I really must remember to stop for the more common antelope tracks, because that's where we got caught out when Renius came to test us on our tracking skills and our knowledge of tracks. Just because you don't track antelope, you don't follow impala, although I did spend a bit of time tracking those pregnant kudu a couple of months ago, but that was more a combination of tracking and guesswork combined. I think I could probably dispose of the hat now. I must say, we've had some of the most glorious evenings since I've started working here. I don't know if it's because of the rain and the green, the sky, the scent has just taken on that proper African summer scent. And the skies have got this deep purplish color as the sun starts to go down. This is the summer that I've always experienced in the bush. Oh, that's beautiful. I'm gonna stop here. And every sunset, every night is totally different. Very, very atmospheric. The company of the giant marula trees. Going back to Trevor's question about the most common tree species, lots and lots of these marulas around this particular area. Giants of the tree world, or some, not quite giants, medium giants of the tree world. Definitely some of the most beautiful. A stunning sunset. And that heavy blanket of silence that descends over the bush as the sun starts to go down. And as beautiful as it is, we definitely can't spend all evening watching the sunset, so let's go back onto the back of Brent's vehicle.
So we're on the patrol for tracks of Karula. Liam and I have been inching down this southern boundary, and so far I'm afraid I am not the bearer of good news. Well, the nice thing about the end of a streak is you get to start another one tomorrow. Pat's wondering whatever happened to the Anderson male. Well, Pat, he's fine as far as I know. He seems to be shifting his territory more to the south, towards the Sand River, which is what's to be expected of a big dominant male. The best territories in the Sabi Sands are along the Sand and Sabi River. So that is why he is slowly moving further to the south. It seems spending less and less time up here in the north. Well, it is a beautiful evening, even though we haven't found a leopard just yet. The game drive is not over. Until the final lady in final control sings. So Tony is wondering, what type of tree do you find most leopards in? Well, most leopards we find, Tony, actually on the ground. But when they do utilize trees, there's a couple of different reasons. One, to store their kill. One, when it's really hot, other dangers. But I'd say in this part of the world, the most common tree to find a leopard in is a marula tree. It's the most common of the big trees. Often got nice branches to lie on. But so I'd say probably the most common tree we find leopards in here. Around the little river, very common, or African ebony, and unnamed, is a tree we commonly find leopards in. But I've seen leopards in all types of trees, and it all just depends on which is the closest and most convenient. So I keep sort of looking over my shoulder, wondering if Karina's going to pop out behind us just to spite me, but so far not yet. Ben, what do you think we do? We drive and then we do one more trip up here in case she's still on her way.
I don't know what else to suggest.
Yeah, there we go. Javier is hunting. She does stay in this northern area to hunt while keeping the cubs to the south. So there is a good chance she might pop across any time from now. And obviously it's quite a long stretch of so we might. I haven't quite decided yet. Wait till we get down to the end. If we don't find each other, we might just do another drive up the southern boundary. So you notice there's a bit of a Ferrari safari going on there, and there's just been a report of some to the east, and those guys are trying to get looking for our leopard tracks. They are rushing off to try to see the cheetah before it gets too dark. Make sure there's no one else coming down. Oh, at a rate of knots behind us. Definite change in the temperature. The chill in the morning is quite pleasant at the moment.
As Brent continues his search, unfortunately, it seems as though his signal just keeps coming and going. It's just one of those aspects of live safaris. You can imagine the amount of technological details that are involved in being able to bring you a picture and sound that is happening immediately. What you're seeing is what is happening right here in the Sabi Sands, in the middle of the African bushveld. And the process is all exceptionally complicated, and I've got no idea how it works. But inevitably, because it is live, things just go wrong every now and again. And we found that our viewers are incredibly understanding in that regard. I know I said that we can't stop the whole time for the sunset and that we just have to move on, or that we should keep moving on, but I must say it's changed now again. And those wispy clouds. And the distant call of a Cokie Franklin. Cokie, Cokie, Cokie. Look how beautiful those clouds are. Streaked. I could only describe them as streaky. Watching the sunset accompanied by the dulcet tones of impala rutting. I can hear them snapping away at each other. Almost looks like ink sort of running through water, those clouds, if you know what I mean. They look liquid. Very, very beautiful. Almost definitely time for us to move on. I want to try and check the hyena den around Philemon's cutline, just in case. You never know, they might have decided to move across in that direction, and since we're losing light, we should do that sooner rather than later. Luckily, we're right here at Philemon's Dip. We're nice and close. I've already got my headlights on, and that's not because I can't see where I'm going, but it's just a really nice way. Once the sun dips down, it's the only way that we have of being able to spot tracks, by just illuminating them and hope that the headlights will catch them at the right angle. Lots of hyena tracks around, fly to the eye, around Philemon's Dip and around Philemon's cutline first thing every morning. I haven't seen any going into the old hyena den site, but I think worth investigating nevertheless, just in case they've been using a different path. And they've always used this road as a highway up and down from the south of Juma into the center of it, past the camps and then up towards the den sites, or north towards the den sites. We'll just have to see. Construction that you might have saw briefly there out of the corner of your eye is the Philemon's Dip pump house. So for those of you wondering sort of about the amenities and the way that the various resources are provided in the bush, that is a borehole pump. In this case it is solar paneled, so rather than they've sort of made the switch from using diesel to using solar power in order to bring water up from deep below the surface and provide and fill up the tanks for drinking water, for shower water, and for all of the needs of the lodge. It's one of the most interesting, because in this particular area, we actually drink filtered water. We have to filter the water before. We don't have to, but it's very, very, very high in lime content. And we also, even for the vehicles, when we put water into the radiator, we have to use water that has been filtered first, because otherwise the amount of calcium that builds up, the lime that builds up, ends up clogging the cooling system of the vehicles. It gives it an almost salty taste. I'm checking for tracks. I'm really just keeping my fingers crossed that this is where they've decided to come, but I don't see any evidence of it, unfortunately. But you never know. Maybe I'm mistaken. Maybe they are here. It's definitely overgrown. Now, this tent site looks completely different to when I first started working here last year, June, when this was the very first active hyena den I ever visited on Juma, back when a little cub called June and Bella and the twins were still young. And that was before the elephants did some landscaping work to this den. It had a huge marula tree growing out of it that is now been pushed over and has died. Unfortunately, all looks quiet here as well, and there's not a single track of any of the cubs moving through. So this den site is about 2 odd kilometers away from the Aubrey's Road den site in a straight line. Miss Lynn was wondering a bit about that. She was wondering how far will a hyena move, or will hyena move their cubs from den site to den site? And the answer is they will move quite far. So the last time they moved from Flimmon's Cutline Den, which is where we are here, they moved across to Gallego Shortcut. That's a distance of about 1.5 kilometers. What's that, 3/4 of a mile? Or just over 3/4 of a mile? But they can move the cubs, even at a very young age, they can move them quite far distances, probably between a maximum of about 2 miles that they will cover in moving. And they'll just decide whether or which particular den site is suitable, and I'd love to know how they decide. We've got a really, really perceptive question that has come through from Rain, who's one of our 15-year-old viewers. And Rain would like to know about the guidelines behind naming animals, and was wondering a little bit about it, whether it was just purely for identification purposes, because it results in the end in attachment to the animals themselves. And Rain, that's a really, really good question. So yes, we name the animals that we see on a regular basis. It's actually not tradition in the safari industry to name hyenas. That's something that we've started doing because, and it makes total sense to me, there are as much characters as Karula, for example, or the Nkuhuma lionesses, for example. Tradition in the safari industry is that leopards, individual leopards, are named. Not necessarily, sometimes it's names that reflect, watch heads, it's names that reflect personality. Sometimes it just reflects the area that they're commonly seen in. Lion prides are not generally named individually. They're just named as a group, and quite often, again, after the area that they're in, or specific characteristics. Nkuhuma pride found underneath a brown ivory tree. And Nkuhuma is the name for brown ivory tree. Styx pride, I'm not so sure about the history behind the name the Styx. Individual male lions will be given names once they start to show individual characteristics. So each of the Birmingham boys, for example, will have their own individual name. Really, some of them do. And hyena cubs, well, the hyenas is something that we've started doing at Wild Earth. And to me, it makes as much sense as naming anything else. And it is such, it was impossible for us to keep track, you know, by saying, remember that set of cubs from last year, June, that we watched at the Philemon's Cutline Den? And the oldest one of those cubs, rather than just saying Bella. It's just so much easier. That's something that started with Wild Earth, and it's not a process followed elsewhere. In terms of your question about creating human attachment, It's something that occasionally we do mention and we do warn the viewers about. And that is the fact that, yes, well, I don't know, it's a difficult one. Yes, once you put a name to something, you do form an attachment to it. But I think that we would form an attachment to Karula regardless of whether her name was Karula and if in fact she'd just been labeled as the K1 female or something similar, because you have to, for identification purposes, label them. You could go down the numbers route. And yes, maybe for us as human beings, names do automatically increase your level of attachment to the animal, which can be wonderful. And for the most part, it is. You get to watch them then go about their day-to-day lives and form an attachment to their personalities. But every now and again, the wild being the wild, something tragic does happen. And then it's heartbreaking for those who have formed the, or for all of us who have formed the attachment to the animals. It's a good point. I personally don't have a problem with naming animals. It's much easier than remembering numbers, and it's useful as a way of identifying individuals from each other. It would get so confusing if we had to number each hyena. Of course, we've all got the exciting prospect over the next year or so of adding and getting to know a whole bunch of new animal characters to our story between lion cubs and leopard cubs. Definitely exciting times lying ahead. And that's the other really exciting thing about cheetah plains as well, and the fact that we will be driving on cheetah plains, expanding our traverse area. Excuse me. Because then we actually get to follow on the story of some of the characters that viewers were watching for years from birth almost, that have now dispersed away. And I'm thinking particularly, of course, about Quarantine and Kunuma, Karula's previous set of cubs, two young boys that have since moved off away from their mother's territory. Rain's question and naming of animals and the attachment that we form to them. And I'm thinking about all of the various named animals that I've worked closely with in my life as a safari guide. And I'm trying to think if some of the heartaches that I've suffered would have been lessened at all by having not named that animal. And I'm thinking of specific examples that have been very sad for me to witness over the years, and you do get some very sad events. And I don't, Rain, I think that they would have been equally sad regardless of whether or not I had named or if I hadn't known the names of those individual animals. I think that attachment is a product of time spent with them. Go and investigate the drainage line system. Having just spoken a bit about Karula, I'm going to go and visit some of her favorite places. Seems as though Brent's signal is back up and running, so let's jump on the back with him.
So we have been relegated to quarantine. That is where we have come. Hopefully we will be with you for a little bit longer this time. So we are approaching the dark hour when all sorts of beasties come out, and quite a few of you more interesting little animals only come out at night. So I'm hoping we might be able to find one or two of those for the last couple of minutes or last half an hour or so. So in particular, we'll be looking for the South African Galego, or bush baby. White-tailed mongoose is another one that we do see around here, and we did have that fantastic visual of an African civet not too far from here not so long ago. But at the moment, all we have is some buffalo bulls in the sunset. Moving away from the Juma Dam, they're going to be heading up towards the high ground to have a nice warm spot for the evening. It's that, almost. Maybe not quite dark enough for the spotlight yet. Just leave it for a few more minutes and it should be perfect. Just checking. The other thing we might find out here is scops owls, or eagle owls, or even the little pearl spotteds. I think I have lost communication. And I have lost communication. Give me 1 second, please, and I'll be back, I think. Cables, cables, cables. That one goes there, so then we need the other end of that. I need all my things, Vim. I need my camera, my binoculars, my wildflower books. And now finding the other end of this is going to be fun. Aha! Success. Okay. There we go. I think when, as I grab the spotlight there. Yes, we can hear them. So we're back. Oh, impala in front of us. So we do have quite a few new viewers, and we won't put this big bright spotlight on any of the diurnal species. So the daytime species, impala, zebra, wildebeest, and such, it can blind them for a little bit, so that's why we don't do it. And it can make them a little bit easier for the predators to catch, so we don't want to interfere either way. Oh, Vim, look at that, look at that, look at that, look at that. That is the shot, Vim. Oh, let's try and get it. There we go. I think, oh no, you silly elephant, you put your trunk down. But look at that, those two little bulls we started with, giving us some exceptional silhouettes on quarantine. Magic. And heard that behind us, and that was an impala ram. Oh, look at that. Isn't that absolutely magical? Well, it seems like they've got an extra friend from when we were with them earlier. There were only two when we had them. There's a third now. Safari Diva is wondering, why does quarantine exist? Now, quarantine back in the sort of 50s was an area where they used to keep cattle. It was a quarantine zone for cattle. So they cleared off a lot of the bush and it stayed open since then. So when they tried to use this area as a cattle farm, it didn't work so well for them though. But that's how quarantine exists and how it got its name. This is magic. Looks like there's a little breeding herd that's joined these two bulls, and some of them will come into shot shortly. Oh, fantastic for them. Susie and I agree completely that this is absolutely magic. It's spectacular. Just gonna sit quietly here and enjoy it. We've got about 60 impala behind us, a lovely little herd of elephants in front of us. Can just see the little baby to the left of the big bull, but he doesn't quite stick into the silhouette. There's a young one to the right there. See those ears flapping to cool down. What do you think if we move a little closer, Vim? We'll still get the nice silhouette.
Remember what happened last time?
Yes. But I don't want to go as close as that, but if we move forward a little bit. Let's try it. Back was better. Back was better. Okay. There. Beautiful sky. Beautiful elephants. Sometimes it's just so wonderful to sit and just take it all in. I mean, we've got some wonderful sounds around us. We've got that crested Franklin calling. A Scops owl, it's just started. Boop. You can hear the elephants feeding. You can hear the little contact calls between the female impala and the youngsters. You hear the occasional raucous effort of a male impala. And even hear the dung beetles flying around. So, spirit in the sky says, just beautiful. I wish we had smell-o-vision so we could experience the scents around here. Well, at the moment, there's a very sort of predominant smell of elephants. And, well, elephant dung in particular. No, it's just being silly impala. We just heard that snort. I wanted to see if I could see the reactions of the others. And, no, they're fine. Just one snorting away there. Beautiful. This is the problem sometimes with the rutting season. Is that the amount of snorts and stuff, you could get excited thinking you've heard an alarm call, but alas, that is not an impala alarming at something. I think that's an impala just snorting for the sake of it. I'm just looking back behind us, and those guys are not taking any notice of the snorts on the other side. But you never know. So let's go have a quick look. And it's getting a little bit dark for these ellies. Well, we go see what's on the other side of quarantine clearings, or more impala. Let's jump back with Jamie and see what she's up to.
This is one of my absolute favorite times to be out in the bush. I think my favorite time to be out is first thing in the morning, just before the sun starts to rise. But this time of day comes in at a very close second. The excitement of all of the different nocturnal species that we can see, I always find incredibly appealing. Just the knowledge that a white-tailed mongoose could pop out in the road just like it did the other day. We actually had two pop out in the road in the middle of the day. Or a serval or something similar. I don't know, I just find that prospect so appealing. And animals that we see even less than we would see leopards, for example. And I think that's why I find it so incredibly exciting. My aim is to manage to get a porcupine on camera. I still haven't even seen one since I've arrived on Juma. And I would very much like to. Seen their tracks. I don't know what it is that I haven't seen that many around. Oops, sorry, impala. I also wanted to go, and Inyala, I wanted to go down just towards the Juma Dam and investigate a funny croaking sound that I heard. That's where I'm on my way to. And of course, there was that exciting serval sighting. Hello, impalalas. Sorry, guys. Can I just come through? Thank you all. No, that's all one. Okay, you go ahead. Shame. Must be a scary thing settling down for the night of your own parlor, although tonight's a nice light night. There's going to be plenty of light about. There's no clouds, there's no wind, so they won't have to be too stressed about being hunted. Or at least they might have a slightly better chance of spotting anything that will come through. What was that? Oh yes, I was talking about the serval sighting that we had. I wouldn't mind an aardvark sighting. There's just so many exciting nocturnal animals in the months ahead. And of course, winter, this time of year, we're not quite in winter, but winter is the perfect time of year to start spotting those animals that we don't always get to see. I wonder what our averages of leopards compared to serval. That serval was the first one I've seen. Brian, how many serval have you seen while you've been here?
I think two.
And Brian has been here a considerably longer time than I have. Those sorts of sightings are exceptionally exciting for all of us. We find we get unbelievably, possibly even high-pitched while we do see that. However, the Juma Pan is quiet, and there's not much around here, and we've come now to the end of our sunset safari. A big thank you to Brian for his fantastic camera work, as always, and his company on the back of the vehicle, as well as to Kirsty and Rebecca in final control. Most importantly, thank you to all of you, the viewers, for joining us and sending through your questions and comments. And we will catch up with you tomorrow morning for the sunrise safari. Have a wonderful day wherever you are in the world, and I'm going to send you back across to Brent for the last few moments.
So unfortunately, none of those little critters I was after on the quarantine clearings. I am just still checking for a bush baby to end. Quite often find them in this area. But how wonderful were those elephants in the sunset. So unfortunately, it does look like our cat streak is over. So we're gonna have to pick up again, start afresh, and try to break the record run from last year of 28 days of big cats. I think we can do it. What do you think, Vim?
Maybe.
It was a good run. Valeria says she's so glad with the... Oh, it's a bushbuckle. Oh, I thought it was something a bit more interesting for a second there. Oh, a young male in Nyala, actually. Valeria says she's so happy with the time changes, we still get a bit of a night drive. Very exciting. I agree, Valeria, and it does give us that opportunity to find some of those smaller, more interesting nocturnal mammals. So there's just a few short moments left of tonight's sunset safari. So I'm going to scoot back towards those ellies. We didn't find anything else on the opposite side. And I do think that impala was just making noise for the sake of it. Oh, but you'll have a look at this mountain of eyes and stuff in front of us here. I'm just going to do this. I don't know if you guys can see the eyes shining back, but massive herd of impala moving on to the safety of quarantine for the night. Still going. Now, where did those elephants go? There they are. So we might not be able to see them too well, but we're going to definitely be able to hear them very nicely. Oh, where you guys going? So sometimes with these ellie bulls, certain breeding herds quite often don't like spotlights too much, but these ellie bulls, particularly the young ones, and especially if you're not using the spotlight, but we're using one of these diffused lights, can be quite comfortable. And there's the gentleman who we started, sorry boy, we started the sunset safari with, so only fitting we ended with him, and he's been making short work of this marula tree. Oh, listen to that, wildebeest. So it has been wonderful having you on the back for this sunset safari. And as I said, quite fitting to start with the same young, to end with the same young bull we started with. And hopefully he'll still be around on the sunrise safari. But alas, an end of our cat streak, 8 days on the trot, not a bad effort. We're gonna have to work a bit harder to break that 28-day streak we had last year. But wonderful, there's still lots of ellies around. And fingers crossed that Queen Karula brings her cubs back tomorrow. Very good chance the Nkuhumas might be back on Juma tomorrow from their general direction. And with Mr. Tingana chasing leopards all over the place, who knows, maybe he'll make an appearance as well. And we're going into the winter months, so remember, the drives are half an hour later than they were. But a big thank you for joining us, and a big thank you to everyone involved, our tech team who are trying to sort out our problems, cameraman in final control. But from us and the Eddie, bon nuit, and see you in the morning.